So I'll call the meeting to order. Notice the meeting was published in the paper before, 3 days prior. Just a brief welcome. Sarah Johnson Rothman, who's the chair of the committee, is sick, and so I'm sitting in her place. We have with us on the board as well Nina Hester, Art Levin with Mark Spurda, Dr. Weber, other members of the cabinet, as well as Ed Piazio from Whistler, who is representing. Are there any announcements or communications? Dr. Weber?
Yeah, I'm done.
All right. There are 2 minutes, January 30th, 2017, February 27th, 2017 minutes have been circulated. If you have any corrections, make sure you let Ms. Evans know. We'll start with our agenda for today, which is actually looking at the second reading and adoption of various policies. And I believe we will look again at policy 08 first, civility. Or actually, is there any, before we begin, actually, maybe Dr. Wilder, is there any pertinent policy that we need to look over today, given the time frame of where we're at?
No, I think just working through the agenda. Michelle, did you have any?
When you say look through, we do have sections, we have some policy under review.
Yeah.
But you're talking about second reading and adoption.
Okay. You're okay. Yeah. All right. So let's begin with policy 08, civility. The first was, I'm wondering on the sentence where it says to practice it on a daily basis, if that's something that we could strike. Sure, it's the second paragraph under the purpose. My suggestion is just to strike the sentence. The best way to promote it is to practice on a daily basis.
I would agree with you, I think that's a given.
Yeah, and I think it's a valid place for a policy.
That's
it.
At work. What does that work mean? Civility.
Right, so strike the words at and work.
I would strike those words too.
I agree.
Yeah.
So strike the sentence, we agree?
First sentence, yes. And I have to thank the board for having this policy because, believe it or not, we do refer to it on a somewhat regular basis. So, again, thank you for provision of this.
I thought you were going to say daily basis.
We do practice it.
Very good, Mark.
If I could interrupt, just so the board knows, while you're looking at your documents in Board Docs, you're not going to see my live edits unless you refresh and I save. So just so you know, the work.
Yes, if you want to see the edits,
yeah.
If you look at the screen, that's where the edits will be recorded.
I just wanted to remind you because it gets confusing.
So under that same paragraph, though, in the third sentence, I want to change his or her to their, just because of the other policies that we've had in regards to gender expression. I think the easy would just end there instead of his slash her. Just replacing with T-H-E-I-R.
You gonna do that?
That's the only mention I did here.
Okay. Do you go back to every policy and make it serve and change?
Not necessarily, but at least because we're reviewing this one.
Shall I make that?
It's just very simple. It's an easy fix. It's more grammatical.
Is it grammatical correct?
Yeah.
Is, except that these days, there's been lots of debate about the proper way to express his or their. Would have been considered grammatically incorrect, 20 years ago, but seems to be the way to do it these days. The other way is to try to reword the sentence, to just avoid the need for the word, but I don't see an easy way to do that right now.
And then the only other suggestion I had was, is in at the end of that same paragraph, actually. It is in the spirit of, it is in this spirit that we establish this civility policy for the district. I still don't think the sentence is necessary. We can just write it.
Well, so presumably the previous sentence, or maybe two sentences together, are meant to establish a spirit, which I agree is not normally something you want in policy. Policy should be legal language, not spirit. So then, if you want to strike this, I question whether you need the two sentences before it.
Yeah.
Is there an accompanying ER for this policy?
No.
Thank you.
Do we intend to have an accompanying ER for this policy?
Ken's office provided a sample, but at the last meeting we determined that the policy was sufficient.
Okay, I think it's sufficient because we have AR wording in the policy. So we could leave it there because it's actually harmful in this case, or we could move it to an AR, which would be a very short AR.
By the way, that sentence, I understood the previous sentences under the purpose of the policy, which I think to go back to talking about, I think this is a good policy for our district to have. I just think that sentence is a little obscure in policy language. Talking about spirit.
That's fine with me, and I would prefer not to go into an AR, because this is, you are civil or you are not civil.
Yeah.
There are not gradients of civility. So this, I think, does the work for us.
Shall I strike that last sentence?
I believe that's the recommendation.
So, are there any comments or?
Yeah, sure, sure.
It's a good policy.
You should get shorter as you
go.
All right, seeing none.
Actually, I love that waiver when you change his or her to their.
Yeah.
I think they need to change instead of any person. You might have to change that to deprive individuals.
Yeah, that's what I was asking.
Of their. Like any person is singular, so his or her.
Right, that's what I was trying to
get at. Yeah.
Any person of their right.
Any person.
Any person of their right. That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, that seems to be the accepted way to do it these days, although I agree to those it seems funny. But you can change it to anyone. I guess that's just singular.
I prefer any person.
Yeah.
Individuals?
To deprive any individual.
Any, what do you have the
well,
any of
the one? That's why you were getting it.
Yeah. You could drop, the simple way, without changing the word, we could drop any and change it to persons. But I agree that that's even more slippery.
Letter B.
Speak words of wisdom. Okay. Let's move on to policy 200, enrollment of students.
Okay, so there's no significant change to this policy. So you have a 4-second meeting.
Yeah. I did have a question, maybe this is for you, Ed, for you, Ed. I've noticed throughout different policies that we use, and I've seen them changed over time as well, the word child versus student. And so in this one, there's a couple uses of the word child. I guess in policy language, which one is typically more appropriate?
It's more common to see student, that would be my experience, but there's no functional difference between them, but if you're looking for standard language, it probably suggests student.
In some cases, in this policy, depending on where you're looking, some of these may not be students yet at the time of their video skills.
That's true.
So I'm not sure where you are, but that would be.
I think as I was looking at a bunch of the policies, I was just noticing that there's distinctions made, and I didn't know if we wanted more some sense of consensus or consistency in our use of that term. That's all.
The word pupil used to be the term that we used, and there's been a shift from that
to students,
generally to students.
So is there a particular use of child?
Yeah, let me see if I can find the one that I paused it.
While you're looking for that, before they get here, they're a child, right?
Exactly, that was my point. I don't know if it matters, but a couple of the footnotes, like under guidelines, the second and third bullets have footnote number 10 and number 11, which are not links. Do they need to be links?
They should be, so.
Yeah. Not 12, yeah, well,
could you, I'm gonna write that down.
Probably, but I'm here, it's received in different school districts.
So 11 and 12.
10, 11 and 12.
10, 11 and 12.
Where the first child rather than student.
Yeah, and again, I don't know if it's a matter of just us, is it, to the point made earlier about his and her, how many of our policies have variations, and do we really want to make these changes if we're going to make that?
Especially if something about emancipated minor.
Yeah.
And there are students at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And we have child, so that should say student if you're, right?
Well, yeah, right, that's the second mention of emancipated.
Right.
Yeah, the whole parents residing in different school districts section.
It's possible that that language was taken right from the Beck, through the Pennsylvania Department of Education, or taken directly from a court case that was decided.
In which case we all want to stick with the language.
Correct. So that may be why there was some inconsistencies. Either way, I don't think you're fundamentally changing the meaning of the policy.
Yeah.
But if there's a particular instance, I can go back and take a look.
Seeing as this is second reading, is there any
second
more?
Mm-hmm.
Any more comments?
Yeah, is there any other? I have a question about all of these actually. Do we have any else for any second reading?
What is this one?
For 200, there should be.
We have a new one, an AR, a new one coming.
Is it in that we're looking at?
That's under the registration section.
Yes.
200. For 200.
I actually don't see one. For 202, there is.
Sorry, I'm
thinking 202. I have new next up 200, 201, and 202, that we bring our new ARs for all three.
I think there's an AR 200 in the system here.
It's a consideration.
It may just not have been listed on the other.
Which is all right. Okay.
So is this the new, is this the new AR? Brooke, if I go to the administrative regulations,
oh, you're going there.
And then for 200, am I looking at the new AR or am I looking at the existing?
It should be under the policy drop down. It should be a section called under consideration, and then do a drop down for
So that's the new one. I don't know if there was another one.
There was not.
Okay, then I guess
this
is the new one.
It's not in the agenda. We don't have it in the agenda.
It's not in the
agenda. It wasn't in the agenda.
You can pull it up under board docs inside.
It's on the screen. I have it on the screen.
But it wasn't. Yeah.
So I go hang on.
So we can all find it first, and then maybe we can review it while we're here.
Yeah. My recollection when we put this together was that most of this language came from your policy previously.
Okay.
I don't believe that most of this language is new to other elements.
So I have to make a comment.
Maybe. You might know you like
it. Yeah, I can walk it again. What was that?
Did you find Mr.
Smith? I found it, but he doesn't see the policies.
Let me read it. Let me log out and log in again.
Policies.
I think because the agenda was so robust as is.
Yes.
The thought of putting, as considering the admin rights in these areas were put off. We were going to look at them a little bit later. So I know Ken's office was working on them. It wasn't the attention to bring to the policy committee today.
Okay.
It was just the policy part.
And it's okay for us to enact the policy without its accompanying regulations?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So they haven't had admin regs ever for those.
Well, but if this policy was designed to have one, then I
the policy can precede the AR.
So let's put the AR on the next agenda.
Okay.
So going back to the policy, is there any other comments?
Yes. So, are we done with 200, Robert?
That's what I just want to make sure everyone's fine. If we are.
So are we going to ask the solicitor to go back and look at child, or are we good enough with meeting notices?
I mean, my personal preference is that I think we should change it to student, because I think it's more appropriate. But all that to say is, to the point, I don't think it's semantic, it's not a matter of belief.
Well, I agree that it would be better, but if this language was taken directly out of a court case or a statute or something, then I wouldn't want to.
Yeah, so we'll just leave it. I'm fine with leaving.
Okay.
Let's just leave. Okay. Moving over to 201, admission of kindergarten students.
And this is the same thing. There is an AR that accompanies, but it's not on the agenda.
So we'll do that next time.
Yes.
Okay. I have a question about some wording which is not new that I didn't notice in the past. Under guidelines, the second or third paragraph begins with beginners shall be admitted to school. A child who is 8 years old when he moves to an impound. What about a child who is 9? I know that this means at least 8, and a child who is 9 is arguably also 8, but.
But is that what the state requires? Once you're 8 years old, you have to be in school.
Compulsory attendance starts at 8.
So that's why that 8 is in there.
Correct.
Okay.
I think it links. One citation was that.
And September 15th, that's not a change, right?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Someone that had left some notes in regards to students who will reach age 6, if that's more appropriate for an administrative regulation.
Where are you?
Someone already, I don't know who put the note, but I'm just going to read it.
Oh, okay.
There's a note on the board docs under first grade. It's like fifth bullets down, or fifth.
There's another one too, so.
Yeah, just want to make sure whoever wrote this, where it is addressing it.
I think this belongs here. It's in the procedure for making the decision in the AR, but it says that you can refer to the AR to make this decision.
Yeah, I'm just making sure that we're addressing the topic. But I agree, I think it was appropriate to do that.
I think the age should stay in policy, and I agree the procedure for early admission can be put in the AR, and I think that's where it's currently slotted to be put. Yep. Okay.
Can you delete that note?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Any other comments or questions?
We have a she here.
Where? Oh, yeah. Under kindergarten.
Where's that?
It's right bottom of your
page. I saw that, actually.
Where is this?
It's right where your picture is.
Oh, here.
She.
I just want the citation number 8 under guidelines was the age of 8. So when you get into the... when you look at the guidelines section,
yes.
I mean, policy citation 8.
It's at the very end. Got it.
Mm-hmm.
So
in enrollment of students at 200, that 8, citation 8, is there. I'm never saying 201, it's not there. We can repeat it.
Because it says
it's in 200. We can add it to 201 as well. I mean, 201 really talks about kindergartners and beginners. When we talk about enrollment of students,
so
we're talking about compulsory education starts at 8, but they can enroll earlier. You know what I mean? Ed, do you think she was in both places? That's identity.
We can add a reference to 201.
If, I don't know if we do, but if we wanted to avoid that she, he, this is an easy one to do. You just flip the sentence around. A beginner, or in the case of kindergarten, a child who has obtained age 5 before September 15th is eligible for admission to kindergarten. And the same for the sentence up above. But I don't know if we consider it important to do that.
I think it would be good for us to clean up that language going forward. At some point or another, we'll have to address it, in my opinion. So I think you might as well address it now in policy.
When you're just changing basically the program, does that require then approval from the board and going to the board? I mean, because if you started from scratch, through all the...
That would have to be for permission.
I'm not changing the program.
No, okay, so we're just it's
okay. 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 Change. Okay. Okay.
So am I changing this to striking it to student?
No.
A child who has the team. So a child is eligible for admission to kindergarten if she has. A child who has attained or will attain the age of 5 before September 15th of the school term is eligible for admission to kindergarten. It's just flipping it around. Who has?
Yeah, actually, you made an accidental good point there. Is it who has or who will attain? Or who has or who will attain?
Makes sense, John.
Who will?
You can just leave it a child who attains.
Nice.
Is eligible at the end of the sentence.
Yeah,
after
the
school term, is eligible for admission to kindergarten. And that's correct.
Spelling error and eligible, and then there's basically the same sentence up near the top
in first grade. Beginners.
Should get exactly go up a little bit more.
Lowercase kindergarten, okay.
No,
that second sentence.
One above that one.
Yeah.
Okay. Who attains?
That doesn't have a lot of people.
Formatting will be better once it's in.
I did have a question for the kindergarten statement where it says there is no early admission to kindergarten. In past precedents, has there been cases where there has been early admission? Or has there been any provisions made in that?
Not since I've been here. Okay. I don't believe so. Okay. We're fairly structured along those lines.
Okay. 1 minute later, 2 minutes.
Well, we had questions about September 16th.
Right,
yes.
That's
what we were. Yeah, we've been
really interested.
Plus or minus one day.
Holding back anyway, you're always better off. Especially on Sunday.
All right. Seeing no more observations or comments, let's go over to 202, please. Eligibility of non-resident students.
Yeah, this is what we're just cleaning up to do.
And the AR is on the agenda for...
This is one more person consideration today.
It's the last item.
I have to change the status. This is ready for...
So we took out the entire homeless piece and we moved it to the other policy, 251. And we struck, if you recall, we struck class 7 at the last meeting. We agreed we would eliminate that. That will be the recommendation for the full board.
Right, so there was a reference to class 7 somewhere in here that we have to get rid of. I saw that earlier today.
Oh, under guidelines, before all the classes begin, we actually list 7 classes of non-residents.
Yeah, that's what it's sort of
change
nice.
That to six.
Yep, yeah. That's what I saw.
I have a question about, and I thought it was discussed before, are there other guidelines? What about delegated responsibility? The last sentence in that section. So this says, if the board hears anything that suggests that somebody might not be a resident, they may investigate it. They're authorized to do so. Are we suggesting or trying to suggest that they should investigate it?
I'm sorry, where are you?
The board authorizes the administration to investigate.
Right, if you let us know, we will investigate.
Well, it says you're authorized to investigate. But let's say some parent says something to you specifically.
Right, that happens frequently.
That some other student they think isn't a resident.
Mm-hmm.
So you're authorized to investigate that.
We do.
Are we encouraging you to investigate, or are we simply authorizing it's up to you to make the decision?
Well, I can tell you that every time that that's happened, and it happens more often than we might think, we do investigate.
We have a process, and I believe it was you and Ms. Hewitt came to the high school. We did a professional development. We developed basically a whole protocol of what to do when you feel that there may be a suspicion of residency. They go through the protocol. Ultimately, they've also been provided letters. So once we go through the protocol and it's verified that the student does not live where they say they do or they're out of district, we have letters that we send to the families. It happens 2 or 3 times a year at least.
Just happened last week.
And it resolves usually prior to going to a hearing before the board.
So my question is actually sort of before that whole process though. My question is, do we as the board in policy want to say that we will actively pursue these kinds of cases, or are we simply authorizing the administration to make that decision about whether to pursue or not?
I think the authorization language in there helps in the event, for example, an investigator needs to be retained to do surveillance or to do home visits, things like that. The authorization is there in board policy that the administration can move forward with retaining those professionals. I wouldn't strike the word authorizes. If we wanted to authorizes and encourages, that might be favorable language, but the authority is key there in the event that anyone needs to be retained to assist with the investigation.
And just for the reporting aspects of child accounting, those type of things, there's procedures, there's BECs, there are basic education circulars that tell us what we have to do so that we report and communicate.
So are there regulations around that that would say that if we were to get wind of somebody who might not be a resident and not pursue it, we would be in trouble?
Well, I think, and I would defer to the legal, being in trouble is subject to some interpretation, but we would not be following and upholding our administrative responsibility if we did not properly report a student that we knew was not a resident.
How about the suspected might not be a resident? I know that would be gray, but...
Well, and you know I'm not very gray. I would want to find out whether the student was a resident or was not a resident.
I can tell you when those calls come to me through the protocol, principals are very on top of that. When they suspect that they're moving through the protocol very quickly.
But that's because we currently establish a culture where that's what we do.
Actually, that culture is somewhat new and really following that. We have had situations much softer in the past where it could have been a bus driver indicating that every day they picked up a child who was sitting in a car with a parent or with an adult. So the information comes to us in a number of ways.
Mm-hmm. At the elementary level, you'd be amazed how much information gets volunteered from the students. You know,
they're just filling, what happened last week.
Filling out a worksheet, you know, what's your address?
It's
clearly not in this district.
So it's
really interesting how sometimes the information is forthcoming.
From the mounds of babies.
All right, so if everyone else thinks this is sufficient, then I'm fine with it. And I'm not necessarily advocating that we should be, you know, stating a policy that would pursue these aggressively, but if we do,
I understand.
We do want to establish a work policy just in case we have a superintendent who said,
let him go. I interpret that as it's my responsibility to make this happen.
Okay.
Great, seeing none other, if we can, let's move over to the administrative regulations since we're at the policy, even though it's on the next section of the agenda, since it's fresh in our minds.
Number 8?
Yes, number 8 on the review. And just go there.
So, normally our AR policy follows sections of the book that our statute and administration, right? This says a person may not know, this is like talking about people who are not part of the district. Is that something we can put in AR? The first sentence? It seems to be addressed to people who don't read the policy manual or the administrative regulations.
Now, these regulations are now posted publicly, correct? I mean, they're
that's
coming out to the policy.
That is true. That didn't used to be true, but it is
now.
I'm not saying willfully present any false information, so they're just saying. You can't normally misrepresent where you live.
And that sounds more like a statement of policy to me than they are. That's not how the administration will enforce the policy, that is the policy.
Yeah.
That language could be moved back to the policy. I think that's a fair statement. And in fact, I think it may be repetitive.
Yeah, it is moved straight to
the policy. Because I think. If we go back to policy 202,
mm-hmm.
I think there's probably a statement in here.
It
doesn't say per se.
Maybe scroll down a little bit under guidelines. I don't see it.
Okay. I don't really see it.
We can move it.
So move that first section back to the policy.
Mm-hmm.
This whole.
First paragraph.
Yep.
So it should that be placed under guidelines, as you were suggesting, or it seems like it would be fitting to put it under authority?
I think it should go under authority.
After that third paragraph, or right around that third paragraph somewhere. That's what I would suggest.
I'm just going to strike that somewhere. All right, that's
your
fussy.
Second line, second paragraph.
striking this paragraph from the AO.
Yep.
Well, this is again a question.
I don't know.
No, that's all right.
So it's not
just disappear at some point and then get it into policy.
And where am I going?
Under authority. So
I put it the first between, right?
I was going to say maybe from the second to third because it ties in with the second to verify the claims.
I hate the word.
Okay.
I would suggest that between the second and the third.
I agree with that.
So go down. There you go.
This is enough of the graphic tools.
This is the policy, so I'm going to save this. Mm-hmm. Here. Okay. All right. And that's simply struck from the.
Ed, because that's new language, but that is that so okay for her second reading? Would that be back?
You have to
do
the first reading. Right. I would send that back.
Back for first
reading. Back for second first reading.
Yes. Second first reading. So that's 202.
Then the policy and the AR will be on the same track. Will be caught up.
Yeah, there you go.
That would be horrible.
It's a hard time. So if we can, let's go back to the regulation now.
The new first paragraph should authorize the superintendent. You know, the district receives credible information, yada, yada, yada. Superintendent should authorize investigation.
Can I, how about the superintendent shall investigate?
Shall. No, because the superintendent doesn't investigate. She authorizes an investigation.
The only thing to keep in mind here is that, let's say an anonymous tip comes in from a community member, the superintendent takes that anonymous letter and may know that there's additional circumstances that are at issue and they may not need to investigate.
This is credible.
Further. So it does say credible, so I think that's a fair point. But I could envision a circumstance where you might receive a tip or you might receive some sort of information and the superintendent may feel that his investigation is not warranted.
That actually happens. We have one extended family situation, and I periodically get emails,
right.
And we know that the person sending right. them it's not accurate.
Right.
So we have had that situation occur.
It's not credible information.
Correct.
Given the previous discussion, there did seem to be the interest in stronger language about pursuing leaving this for this good. But if you're now saying you want it to be, you want us to put it somewhere in writing that we're going to aggressively investigate these things, is that what you're suggesting?
You could rephrase that to say the superintendent shall, as appropriate, investigate, or shall, as he or she deems appropriate, investigate, or something like that. So that the superintendent is taking some action, but it's not necessarily an investigation.
That's better for you?
I think the language is fine the way it is.
Good. And that process you're talking about, Michelle, that's this process is.
Yes.
Okay. Michelle, when you say due process, is there actually a due process here this time?
It resolves before we've gotten there in the last 3 years.
Yeah.
Yes, ultimately.
It's not uncommon to have, just like you would with an employee. employee grievance or a termination matter, there's a hearing before a hearing officer who would make the determination and present a recommendation to the board.
Under verification and investigation, there's a set of bullet points. One of them is surveillance by district personnel or outside contractors, and Ed, you mentioned this possibility earlier. There's nothing here that would authorize specifically not surveillance, but you know, other, you know, if we were to contract out with someone to go get other data, but something other than surveillance, you know, utilizing various internet services that provide these things for a fee, isn't mentioned as a bullet point here. I wonder if it should be.
I think that's a good point. And most of the time, when an investigator is retained, those are some of the steps that they take. So maybe surveillance is not the appropriate word here. Maybe such an investigation could include, I don't want to say investigation again, but
involvement.
Acquisition of data.
Yeah.
Historical records.
Surveillance by district personnel or retainer of outside contractor, something like that.
It authorizes district personnel to do surveillance. It doesn't authorize district personnel to go pay for a. I wonder what these things. There must be a term for these services. I don't know what it is.
Private investigator.
Yeah.
One thing is like 411.com or anyone that says where you can go look yourself up and it has data about, you know, every place you've ever lived and people you've lived with and approximately how old you are, what phone numbers you had in your history and all that. And you can just pay $10 and get a whole history of a person.
A lot of times the investigators will run license plate numbers to find out where the car is registered, if they're tracking a car. So it's definitely a point. Why don't we make two separate bullet points? Mm-hmm. Let's make one related to district personnel, and let's make a separate bullet point, retainer of outside contractors for investigative services, or something like that.
What is the sentence for the district personnel? Home visits by district personnel. You can put those two together. Because the home visits is usually our security officer, et cetera.
They do more than that, don't they? I mean,
they don't go into the house.
They don't leave the house. So watch your kid to see if the kid goes into the house or is picked up by a car, probably.
Want to take out the surveillance by district personnel bullet, you could just add to the home visits bullet something, home visits or other investigation by district personnel. Is that
a take?
Strike that.
Or add this to, add this section to up here?
Mm-hmm.
surveillance, am I saying?
Or other investigation by district personnel.
But if you just move retainer up, it might just, the form.
Yeah.
I would still put a surveillance in there, home business, comma, surveillance, or other investigative, other investigation by district personnel.
Comma, surveillance?
I would.
Yeah.
And because there may be opportunities, for example, bus driver, to observe somebody in the vehicle at, sorry, bus driver.
So I have two questions about this administrative regulation as well. One is, typically we have some form of documentation form record keeping to that. And then the second part of is that, do we also need to add some of that language about how we're keeping records management, et cetera, and things like that, which is, it's the same question I asked for a lot of the stuff that, in particular, something on this sensitivity, I would think we would want to make sure that we have good documentation and record keeping.
We do have a form that the principals fill out when there's concern of residency. Whether you want to make that part of the admin reg or that's just an internal working document, which seems to be more verbally used at this time. I mean, I could share it for the sake of policy committee seeing what it looks like, but I don't know what your recommendation is for making that part of.
You're asking whether the form should be attached as an attachment or something like that?
It's an internal way of documenting the keeping record, but I don't think it has to be a public document.
I would not recommend making the referral form.
What about the language in terms of how the district is managing? Like, for example, all these data points that we just talked about here and under these bullets, how is that going to be kept and managed? And that's why I think I'm asking more so in terms of the regulation. Are we adding that?
So we have a policy that says how records will be kept and destroyed and that kind of thing. So if there are records, they're automatically subject to that, and we don't have to mention it here. The only reason to mention it here would be if we want to explicitly say that this data will be retained for some period of time or in some particular way, then
in my thought would be,
I don't think we want to say that unless there's law that says we shall, right?
Right.
So,
well, I guess my thought would be is that anything that could possibly be heard in, you know, let's say a board hearing, that we would just want to make sure that there's as much documentation and the language is expressed in the regulations so we're collecting that information. Currently right now it's pieces here that we're saying we're good, but we're not saying where it's gathered.
Is there something about the board hearing in this AR?
There is, I think so. Sorry.
So, request a hearing before the board, hearing shall be scheduled. Notification shall be sent.
Do we have
data will be shared regarding that hearing?
When we do hearings in lieu of expulsion, when we do hearings, any other hearings, do we have a separate in the policy? Do we have, or regs, do we have information about how we're going to maintain those records?
Usually the expulsion has to do with discipline and that ties with discipline records, which is records retention.
Right.
And how you have to share it. But not residency.
But it doesn't tell us how to, it just says we will.
So if it's consistent.
The reason to put it here would be to prevent something wrong happening. What's the wrong thing that would happen if we don't put it here? That we get to the hearing and not have the information. Is that what you're concerned about?
But we didn't have a procedure in place to get it at the right place at the right time.
We have a procedure that we run through Ken's office. It's just not part of the admin, right?
And the records of the investigation would then become part of the evidence that's presented at the hearing. And if there's insufficient evidence presented at the hearing, then the hearing officer would presumably issue a decision that corresponds to that. So generally, the way these play out is the evidence is gathered, the records are gathered, they become part of the school district's exhibits when you move, or the administration's exhibits when you move to that hearing. And then they become admitted for purposes of the record at that hearing. I don't think there's any need to add additional procedures about how the records will be kept. That said, there's not anything that would preclude that either.
Well, excuse me, but any time that we have a legal matter, and I would view this as a legal matter, we very carefully put together files, and once again, the result of how this would be handled, determining if the child or the student was resident or non-resident, would need to be reported to the state. And so the child accounting records, if you will, have to be maintained. So at any level, that's all information long before you get to an expulsion hearing, of course. But, I mean, residency has to be documented, and we compare reports frequently. It's much easier now with the computer system, obviously. Am I answering or helping or?
That's fine. I was just more asking whether or not we're missing it or not. It seems as though we're not missing it, so it's fine. I think all of our other policies don't present that language.
Just to remind everyone, as far as for every child we have in matters in child accounting, and our basic ed subsidy is driven on our membership. So everything that we're talking about here is related to the membership and attendance of students, which ultimately impacts state aid. So we look at it, and then when the state auditors come in occasionally, they will look at this as well in documentation. They haven't for the last two state audits, I will tell you, but they certainly can.
I mean, one place that you could add, if this would help, we do have the procedural safeguards notice for change of non-residency. So the following due process requirements apply in formal hearing. But we have that. I don't know if you want to add that. That would be appropriate.
This section?
Procedural safeguards notice, charge of non-residency. This was provided by your office as well. This is the procedural. This is what we attach with the letter,
correct,
the residency letter that we provide to families when we suspect that they are not living where they are living in. It talks notice of recommendation for exclusion and opportunity for a hearing letter.
Correct.
So again, I don't think these are things that we're necessarily link there, maybe the procedural safeguards, but also our letter. And again, not one. Once a parent gets this letter, it resolves. I mean, we have not, because this talks about we'll be charging you tuition because of this date, et cetera.
And sometimes those letters get customized a little bit based on the circumstances of the non-residency. So sometimes it's that enrollment paperwork has expired. Sometimes it's we have credible information from the anonymous complaint. Sometimes it's something that the student reported. So we customize those letters a little bit on a case-by-case basis. So I would not recommend putting a letter as an attachment to the AR. And so I don't know whether I would recommend, I don't think it makes any sense to make as an addendum to this AR an attachment to that letter if we're not attaching the letter.
Because honestly, for a student to stay when they don't live here, that's theft of services.
Yeah.
And so once parents understand that, and then the consequences associated with that,
correct,
they tend to fix on their own.
Wait, are we good? All good with the regulation 202?
Yes.
Let's move back to policy 810. I do want to try to finish off 810 for sure.
So is the AR coming back then?
The AR should be going for first reading.
The AR.
It
needs to come back to the committee because we're doing a second first reading.
Yeah. Oh. That's the policy though.
Yes.
Not the AR.
But this is coming back.
Could you change that one second?
Please.
The AR could be approved, but I would recommend that we wait until the policy.
You think we should?
Yeah.
That's what I was wondering.
Wait until the policy. Mm-hmm.
So the famous policy 810.
Only thing I want to say about 810 is we also need to explicitly say that 810.2, which is the one we combined into 810 on recording devices, we also reviewed and agreed that we're moving into 810 that we usually do. For some
some reason it's not here.
It will be on the motion.
Yeah. But I'm saying nothing about working in late hand.
For foster
students. That's in the review section. Yeah.
In the review?
Yeah. I can bring that up.
And we can discuss the AR.
It's right at the bottom.
I mean, we should discuss the policy on the AR if anyone has anything to say. Yeah, I'm hoping that nobody has anything to say.
I did have one question, it'll be small, but it's small enumeration levels, it's not a big one. But when, I think we talked about it last time, I just wanted to make sure I asked it again. Right above delegation of responsibility, that's students in kindergarten, should that be enumerated number 5? I think I asked it last time, but I forget.
We decided it shouldn't be, it was a separate. I can't find it now.
Every time I look at it, I think it should be number 5. That's okay. We can move 4.
You got to
move it back to 4. Yeah.
Okay, we're good. I just every time I look at it, when I look at it again today, it's all the same thing. All right. Let's move forward to the administrative regulation next.
I have a question. Under general guidelines, second paragraph, school bus drivers shall not permit. School bus drivers shall not permit any animals. Why are we putting down school bus drivers and not just saying animals of certain animals that are not permitted? Do we have something else in here? I didn't find it that says school bus drivers, you know, have the leeway to permit things that they wish to permit, and we're saying that they, except for this, in which case, as written, it would make sense, but I didn't find that.
Well, the following paragraph, at the discretion of the bus driver, a student boarding a bus carrying an item in violation, like size-wise, they can't hold on their lap, so that is at the discretion of the driver.
So if it were the other way, and you said, you know, the driver has discretion to allow various things, except these things. Or just change this sentence to say, unless we're trying to, if this is what I think what we're trying to get at, is explicitly saying, animals of the search animals, explosives or anything dangerous or of acceptable nature are simply not permitted.
As determined by the bus driver.
I'm not even sure I would say that.
Yeah.
It could be.
Well, objectionable nature as determined by the bus driver.
Oh, okay, right, that's where that is. Okay, that needs to be parenthesized in some grammatical way. Because otherwise, you might say that weapons as determined by the bus driver are not objectionable.
So, nature, comma, as determined by the bus driver, comma.
Your separate service animals policy, do you have one?
Yeah. We do.
And so we probably should cross-reference that.
Mm-hmm. I might be willing to permit to let the school bus driver make a decision about some animals. You know, if someone is bringing a gerbil in a cage.
Well, no. I'm not thinking of it.
Allergies.
What's that?
Allergies.
So certainly with regard to weapons, explosives, that should not be at the discretion of the bus driver, mm-hmm. in my opinion. And maybe we need to split this into two things. There's things that are explicitly prohibited, and then there's separate things that are allowable at the permission of the bus driver. And then we can discuss whether animals, which of those categories animals belongs in, but I just don't want to leave weapons and explosives at the discretion of the bus driver. That's what I'm trying to get at.
Makes sense to me. to make that change.
I sense, though, it's the objectionable nature is determined by the bus driver.
I think that's what's
other than weapons or explosives.
But it's also the very first beginning in the paragraph. School bus drivers shall not permit. Like, if this is the school bus drivers making this decision.
But there's nobody else on the bus to do it.
Well, when they get out in the morning, it's
still.
Well, I mean, they're the ones who have to enforce it, but they're not permitted.
Okay.
Right.
So there's a separate policy that has a prohibition on weapons, a prohibition on tobacco, a prohibition.
And those things travel those school buses?
Students are already subject to those. I think the intent here is to say, you know, students have an independent obligation not to bring explosive onto the school bus. This policy is simply stating the direction that you're given to the school bus driver, sort of to enforce those policies. You're not to let someone on the bus with an explosive, even though they have an independent obligation not to bring explosive onto the bus.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is this AR is written for the bus driver.
Well, it's a long AR, so I think parts of it probably could be interpreted that way.
But this section of the AR is aimed at the bus driver, not at the staff.
I mean, otherwise, you're right, because what I'm saying is basically a statement of policy as opposed to an AR. We're in an AR here.
Mm-hmm.
And there already is a policy that covers weapons and explosives.
So in the middle of the next page, there's a sentence that says, the school bus is considered school property,
yes.
Therefore students are expected to conduct themselves in accordance with their school's code of conduct. So that's certainly written for the students.
That statement actually also sounds like a statement of policy. But I didn't say that because that would require us to look at it.
I mean, one of the things you can do is instead of having that, I mean, you can take that language out of the AR here, and we can just put in a series of rules for the bus.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have draft language; it's already written. We can send that if you'd rather do that and not have kind of the more broad statements that do sound a little bit like policy language. Those rules would say things like, don't bring items on the bus that are prohibited, you know, you can't have body parts hanging out of the window, you can't, all those types of things. So we can take a renewed look at the AR here.
Does anybody else think that there's something to address here, or am I?
I mean, I think to the conversation about the policy that covers the main part of what you were trying to get at, that, I think this is fine the way it is. The board is just.
Maybe I would be interested, since I've kind of become de facto director of transportation and looking at the list, but just, I don't know, Tom, what do you think as far as helping direct with transportation? The broader language that we're seeing here and Mr. Sirota's comments. Or, I hate to say laundry list, but more of a... And I'm just administrative. If the board wishes to keep it as it is, I will.
I think this is adequate.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't an AR. It's not in policy.
That's
so,
correct.
So, if we say here that the school bus driver shall not permit any animals, that doesn't necessarily imply that they can permit. Does it imply that they can permit other things? I mean, is this...
Well, I think that leads to the next paragraph.
Well, they can explicitly permit larger things. But that's about size as opposed to about the nature of the object. Like, it almost feels like that paragraph. Gym bags is too specific. Like, this paragraph is about size. It should be explicitly about size, but as opposed to about the nature of the object.
Does it help if you take by the bus driver out of there? And because you're sort of saying here, you know, not permitting animals other than service animals, weapons, explosives, and anything dangerous or objectionable nature. take out as determined by the bus driver on the bus while transporting students. I mean, I guess it still infers that the driver is going to make a...
So it still says school bus driver shall not permit blah, blah, blah on the bus while transporting students. So they are permitted when they're not transporting students. That's an interesting... I hadn't followed that before. I kind of think we wouldn't allow them to take down the bus ever.
And gym bags is specific because it says unless they can be held on the student's lap without endangering the safety of the student, so it does imply size.
Yeah, it implies size. It doesn't say it's about size.
It has to be lap.
Yeah, it has to be put on your lap.
Yeah.
So,
and this is what children carry on school buses.
Right.
Yeah. So, by policy, are weapons, explosives, or anything of dangerous or objectionable nature allowable on the bus if there are no students on the bus?
Well, it goes back to the fact, I believe, that school buses are school
property.
So I think not.
So, I would, yes.
So do we even need this whole paragraph?
I would think it's okay to keep it in the regulation for the simple fact that it's relating just to transit. It's probably reiterating of much of policy, but it's just giving a very specific in regards to making sure that the bus driver then knows.
The problem with it is that it implies, so they're not permitted while transporting students, it implies that they are permitted at other times, or it implies that the school bus driver has some leeway that they may not otherwise have, because there's other policy that says that they don't.
But there are other policies that refer to students or weapons, explosives. We already have other policies that address the same issue. This is just replicating the same things we've already established in other policies.
Right, but the nature of the language suggests that there are alternatives. That's right.
Well, maybe it makes sense then to take out on the bus while transporting students and leave the rest of it.
So taking out
while transporting students. It's fine.
So it's still that would be better, but it still implies to me that the bus driver has some kind of authority that they don't have.
He actually does. He has the discretion to make a decision.
He has the discretion not to try to make a decision about weapons or explosives.
On the bus.
Well, so I'm looking at 417.1, which says the Arts and Weapons Policy. For purposes of this policy, district property means all property owned by the district, including school buses, and it says it's not allowed. And so I would think, again, that...
It's all covered in policy.
Yeah.
I guess I'm not seeing any value, and I am seeing some danger in this paragraph.
I don't see the danger of keeping this policy. I mean, the regulation.
I understand your point, Mark, but I think if we see it in light of the fact that we're just, it's for the bus drivers to acknowledge that they're trying to enforce the policy more or less, but not for them to be judged.
Bus drivers are reminded of the policy, blah, 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 yeah. Blah, blah, blah. We could say that explicitly without implying that they have more authority than they do.
Okay, and maybe that's a more appropriate way to say it, which is, so school bus drivers are...
Shall enforce
district policy regarding use of weapons on school property, or that's weapons awesome. On school property. Mm-hmm. And service animals for that matter.
Right.
Yeah, so maybe we can reword it that way. So let's see if we can enact that sentence. School bus drivers shall enforce.
Shall enforce.
Or maybe you say something to the effect of all district policies are applicable on the school bus as enforced by the school bus driver. or the school bus driver shall enforce all board policies.
Yeah,
they, because if you just list out a few of them, you run the risk of missing a few others, and the bus driver says, well, I didn't know I was supposed to enforce that one. So I think it's best to have a statement that says all board policies and administrative regulations remain in effect on school buses. The school bus driver
is responsible.
Is responsible for enforcing such policies and regulations.
I like that.
What you just said. Yeah, let's try that.
Your general guidelines.
Yep.
I think we're going to replace that whole paragraph.
Okay.
To say.
Can I just take it out?
Yeah.
Or do I have to redline
it? So yeah, first.
You know what, though? I do think there's something specific should be said about weapons and explosives on the bus.
Okay.
I really do think that's necessary.
Okay, all right. Well, then let's say.
Sometimes children don't even know that they need
all board policies.
Carrying a weapon.
And administrative regulations. As well as school rules. Remain in effect. While students are being transported or on the school bus, on school vehicles, don't limit it to a bus. A school vehicle driver. Have the responsibility to enforce such policies, regulations, and school rules. Including but not limited to. Those relating to
weapons and explosives.
What's the name of the board policy? Is it called weapons?
That all fell into discipline now.
Okay.
So with all of our discipline moving to
including those
218.
How about for including
218
not limited to those prohibiting weapons, dangerous objects, controlled substances, and other prohibited items.
Section on. Well, yes, believe me, I've been digesting this and the
Does that work for everyone? That language?
I like it a lot better than.
That's fine. Yeah. Yeah.
Nita, does that still cover what you were?
I think so. Yeah. I'm good with it.
Right. Have we dropped that bomb a minute ago?
Ed, not to mention pick up on your word usage, but you changed bus to vehicle, to bus driver to school vehicle driver. Should that be replaced throughout?
I think it should be replaced throughout. So that vans, like a new van, or I guess there's a problem with it too, but.
Yeah. I can do that.
Are there distinct things in policy and elsewhere in policy?
Well, that's not going to last right now. Yes.
Yeah, the regulation.
Yeah.
It could be the FAC.
Yeah, the ARD.
I just want it all the way for adoption. Months and months and months.
Not more than that.
You don't want, you don't want to talk about it next month.
So, and I'm not willing to change the policy on the result of that, but where it's mentioned in the policy for the same reason, can we change that and have it be merely semantic so that?
Yeah, vehicle versus bus.
Yeah.
I think that's fine.
Okay.
I'm comfortable characterizing that as a non-substantive change.
So
it will not preclude.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. I don't want to hinder. So if we can, policy.
There were leaves on the green.
So I'm replacing all the word bus with school
bus. Bus is school vehicle. And maybe bus driver, school vehicle driver.
Yeah.
Which I do agree, that's a good change. Because there might be.
And we're just doing that in 810.
810,
G10.
And then the R here. Yep, exactly. Mm-hmm.
And these can both be moved.
So in the next paragraph, which I'm sure Mark would have had fun with if he had stayed on the size things, I do wonder whether or not we need to be this specific there. I had a question when I was reading this as well, in terms of even listing the instruments, there is a specific aspect of all these names, and it's near and dear to our heart. But can we just kind of more or less say any objects that are too large beyond your lap are not prohibited, instead of specifying these specifics like gym bags, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, you know what though? I think that it helps the students really understand or recognize what the object is if you list it in the regulation.
My fear about a lister always is that if you miss one.
I know. But if you don't have specifics when it comes to kids,
then we get into the phone call from the parent, where if it says no trombone, then it's clear it's no trombone.
But honestly, when they're carrying the case, unless they open it up, you wouldn't necessarily know what was in the case.
Oh, yes.
Well, I mean, I just think that's another layer of.
We can get into the weeds.
Exactly.
We're getting into the roots of the weeds.
Yes. Yeah, it's much. I mean, we can put that in the student handbooks and things like that, not necessarily in the regs.
I don't think it hurts to keep it anywhere.
I agree. It gives guidelines, and that's the purpose here. Then the discussions about what is or isn't doesn't include these items. So your sousaphone, your melophonium. We know that that's not permitted on the bus.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you.
We can. Under the top, I have my list of comments I made. Under bus garage hours, I don't know if we want to add language about subject to change depending weather. I mean, we live in the Northeast, so if.
I don't know if weather changes the hours of the bus garage, unless I close all district offices, but I don't know that needs to be in the AR.
I guess I'm just asking more so.
Sometimes we stay later, but the overtime's approved, and it's usually more based on activities that are going on. But as Dr. Wheeler said, the weather might make it.
Yes, ma'am.
You can add the word regular if you want.
I like that.
Thank you.
Good suggestion.
I don't think office hours seem to be capitalized either. Yeah, maybe it's the roots of homies, but.
Which is where we tend to hover, so it's all good.
I was wondering if we can alter the sentence under general guidelines. The second paragraph, or third sentence, I should say, in the first paragraph. The district is not able to select bus stop locations or to schedule pickup or drop-off times based on current or convenience or preference. When I read it, I just thought it was a little. I think we could word it. I understand the spirit of it.
actually like this language.
Yeah.
I actually like the language. It's pretty specific.
I'm not picking it out, just rewording it.
Yeah, I think it's specific. And sometimes you need to let people know that it is not evil. I think that's...
The district will not select West Side locations.
The latter part of the policy of this regulation in regards to certificate of insurance, I had questions in regards to how we have enforced it. And do we enforce this?
Where are you?
Under the certificate of insurance.
Six.
Okay. Sorry, where are you? I'm just looking.
I think it's page six. Filing restrictions. Yeah.
Certificate of insurance.
Filing restrictions.
Yeah, driving a student.
The students.
By district club sponsor.
Oh, yeah. Driving students. District club sponsor.
We've
got that issue.
I think we certainly discourage staff from doing.
Actively
discourage. And we request that they use a district vehicle so that we're aware.
Okay.
In vans. Or we sometimes have where the district actually rents or leases a van or a vehicle if we're out of equipment. So mainly it's our concern would be based on this. My understanding, and Ed helped me out with this, it would be if they're using a private vehicle, which if we find out that that's happening, it is strongly discouraged, yeah. If not just outright denied or suggested that they use a district vehicle.
I guess my question was also in regards to, so if that does happen, are they actually providing their certificate of insurance each time? And it says here that the principal or our supervising administrator shall hold these on file. And have we done this in terms of practice?
Well, does this new language, it's green?
I think so.
Mm-hmm.
So part of this is when this is finally adopted,
okay.
We'll have to have
we'll make sure that.
Okay. Part of what we do at our admin council now, which is a monthly meeting, as Michelle goes through everything that's and updates everybody.
And we will also, I will certainly go over with transportation to make sure that they're aware that sometimes requests can be more informal perhaps than we would like, and so that we'll follow up there as a check and balance.
Not to belabor the point, there's, I don't know how many uses of his, her, and there's actually a her slash his, so either way in terms of consistency throughout this regulation. I just make the suggestion to change it. Yes. And then the other thing that I know it seems like it's my personal bit, but it's not, we've, over the time in the policy committee, have changed audio video to just recording. Mm-hmm. But it's mentioned throughout again, and so for your background, Ed, in previous meetings, instead of trying to delineate audio and video, we just simply said recording, which would be good to probably strike all those as well. There's a whole bunch of attachments. Just make sure we've reviewed these.
Under section M, which is on page 10, second to last page, do all of these titles apply here? See reference to Director of Operations, Assistant Superintendent.
We do not currently have an Assistant Superintendent. We do have an HR Director, principals. We do have a Director of Operations,
okay.
A
supervisor of transportation. We actually have a director of transportation also.
Instead of operations, that's what we should
use. Let's change that to transportation, because
I don't know.
Right at the very bottom.
I have number two.
Two B, or no, two A, two and two B. It looks like. Okay, two. No, two B is fine. Two. Change operations to transportation.
It's also in R3,
yes.
Like right at the very end.
And
there's also somewhere in this AR that says that the video recordings will be periodically erased. And instead of using the word periodic, I think it should say in accordance with the board's record retention policy. Because I think periodic can indicate that it's not on a fixed timeline, and it really should be.
But that would mean maintaining this for 7 years?
No, it doesn't have to be. It can be much shorter.
And it needs to be for a number of reasons, because you have the backups and everything that's related to that. So.
Okay, I see.
And don't we have a policy on that? Didn't we go into that on video recordings?
I think it's all been merged. It's not been merged yet. I'm not sure.
Well, Dr. Wheeler, and perhaps we should have related to outside, but I wasn't thinking about maintaining those for transportation at the time.
Mm-hmm. Robert, we haven't looked at these attachments.
We haven't. Attachment
one is blank. One is contradictory to the regs that we're just writing. So I think the attachments.
So we need to go back to
attachments. They're not.
Under attachment, B
talks about a permission slip to transport
right.
A student within your
right.
Own vehicle.
Intervals determined by the individual characters.
But this is an admin rec, so it wasn't
okay.
Anyway, but the attachment.
Okay.
You do a control find.
So we have to make sure, don't think that the next time you're doing a control attachment.
She's on attachment C. Can you make the correction as well? It's a director of operations there. So we just change that, I think, to Director of Transportation, right?
Mm-hmm.
What we're saying.
Okay, so there it is.
On the passion seat.
Would we be raised periodically by overwriting the data?
Okay, all right, that's
okay.
That's okay. I think that's okay.
These all have been, they're all at the bottom. These are all created by Whistler. The forms there, and
all, right,
all
so
these attachments.
Okay.
A is blank. B is a permission form to transport a child in your own personal car, which we just said we're not doing.
Carryover from a different district or something like that. They may have been meant to be presented as examples. So I will go back and take a look. Attachment A should be.
There's nothing in there right now.
That should be the form that gets filled out when parents or guardians. Or the child picked up in a separate bus stop.
Okay, and then look, when you see B, maybe B says, I allow my child to be transported in a private vehicle, so we want to get rid of B completely.
Get rid of B?
Yeah, because we just said that we're not going to.
Well,
unless they provide their insurance, then maybe they just.
I think it also says volunteer, which would be another situation. Sponsor employee and or volunteer. I don't know if a volunteer could be a student driving themselves or if it's necessarily even needs an adult.
We can come back next month with a recommendation about the attachments.
Okay.
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 Back to
community.
This will come back.
Michelle, this will
but we're still putting forward
the
policy.
We're still
making
policy.
Yes.
Just bringing back AR.
Right.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Is there anything else in the regulation?
On the agenda, this is where we're going to talk about the MOU, the foster care MOU.
And that's already been approved by the board, but it's just attached for it.
Perfect.
Will that be under the AR or under policy?
We have it under the AR.
I just didn't know what other districts were doing.
Yeah, that should be there.
Did everyone get a chance to review the MOU? Did everyone get a chance to review the MOU? Where it was
open? I think it was approved.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Okay. So this is already approved. Yes.
So let's go to, and that's, are we done with the AR? 810 for now?
810. So that's going to be first reading?
I think we're bringing it back.
AR 810. Back to committee. The policy is moving forward for second reading and adoption on the 3rd.
Yep. Okay, administrative regulation 216, records retention.
Attachment C.
It's attachment C to AR 215. AR-216. AR-216 has attachment A, attachment B. This is just a revised attachment C. And the reason this got brought back was because I think the board adopted a prior schedule which contained the 99-year requirement yes. for retention of some records. And we, after that, we realized that that was no longer a regulation that was intact. So it was requested that we come back with a retention schedule that, you know, was less burdensome given that that regulation had been repealed.
Is that language then that's only going to be changed in the regulation? It wasn't mentioned in the policy, just to make sure?
The specific retention periods were not mentioned in the policy. They were simply, it was just, there were references to the attachment C.
Was there anything in the regulation that mentioned that? Make sure that we all.
I don't believe so. I can double check that, but I'm almost positive.
Just to make sure that it wasn't mentioned in the regulation as well, as not just in an attachment.
The 99-year requirement wasn't mentioned anywhere else, I don't think.
Unless the citation, which I don't think is
right. And it could be at some point in the future that these retention periods change again. The Department of Education has been tasked to come up with retention periods. It's been a couple years and they've still not done that, but they may be forthcoming at some point in the future and then we have to relook at this again.
There is actually one mention of it.
Is there?
Yeah, so Regulation 216, Section 3, Maintenance Instruction. It says, grade level completed and year complete shall be maintained for at least 100 years beyond the date the student attains the age of 24.
So we don't even have the policy.
Now, this is Regulation 216, so I just wanted to make sure that we clear that as well. This is under Roman numeral 3, Section A, at the bottom of the first paragraph. Go down. Down.
Sorry, it's just freezing on me.
So that right there. Let's see.
I would just take out that sentence. Students official ministry of government.
Then we have to take out.
Which sentence? Something?
Right after the C attachment C. No. Start it there.
Students official.
Start it there.
So take this out?
Correct.
Everything out.
What's ESI stand for?
electronically stored information.
This is a regulation.
I mean, the student learns lots of them have a chart. I got something to
add about being referred. And everything will fit into other.
Right.
So, what we just draw, what you're thinking is everything's contemplated on the chart because there's this catch-all category.
Yes.
I agree with that. You could take out that previous sentence as well.
In addition to the old attachment C, is at the bottom of this regulation.
Can I remove that now?
Where there's
a picture, right? Yeah, if you go down to C.
Yeah, that's the one we want to figure out. Because that was the one that we had questioned last time. Mm-hmm.
Correct. So when this AR attachment C is adopted,
all that
this one that would be taken out completely.
I like this one a lot better.
It's a lot shorter. Everyone is quickly adopting this. Sports
runners, sports runners.
So it's having another. So transcripts and all that stuff falls in the other category? After 6 years, we can.
Correct. There's no affirmative requirement to keep all that information. The board's not precluded from doing that, but there's no affirmative requirement to do that.
Mm-hmm. What would you recommend to me? Because we do have the other ones attached in the actual document. Should I say C attached? Attachment C attached? The other ones are in there.
We should change that.
Should we take them out and make several attachments?
They should be separate documents.
Yeah. Okay.
And in order to make sure that we advertise that the AR was put under consideration, is that coming back? How do you want to do that? Because we advertised.
Just attachment C.
Just attachment C.
Yeah.
If we're making changes to the AR, we probably should
re-advertise. Just because we had strike that language,
correct.
I don't think it would be good to do.
So when you say re-advertise.
For next month.
Maybe so back to committee.
Bring it back. Yeah. So it would be attachment C. I would just list it as AR 260.
Yep.
Attachments.
And I'll create the attachments separately.
Then everyone's fine with the new attachment C.
Yes.
Okay. Right. Okay, moving forward. 204, copy of our attendance.
Does discipline have like the shortest retention? It's kind of bizarre.
The discipline records, that's specifically in the school code. I think it's section 1409, which says that discipline records have to be maintained for a certain period of time.
What is the shortest?
Actually, no, I take that back. It's 1409 is health records. Student discipline records, there's no retention period, but it's assumed, and I'll defer to the administration here, but as I understand, student records generally don't follow from elementary to middle school to high school.
But under school code, discipline has to. You have to send the discipline records.
Oh, really?
From level to
you
level.
Can't, right, you can't get back from discipline.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But 2 years after.
And not the college.
But 2 years after the student graduated, you can shred them.
In a confidential and secure manner.
Sure. Shredder. Okay, so we're already looking at this one.
I think we're on 204.
Yep, 204. It's a short one. Mm-hmm. So.
Policy. EAR or the policy?
We're looking at the policy first.
Policy first, okay.
We're good at 204?
Shoot.
Sick of the regulation. Not much to comment on that.
So 204 can go for a first reading?
Yes.
And this incorporates all the new truancy law updates, right?
Correct.
This is not a substantive. Can we change that second sentence there? So you just have the board policy go first. The board policy and the accompanying administrative regulation. It's just preference.
Well, because we're in the, so this reg and accompanying, right?
Yeah, but I just think typically we just have, we always say policy precedes regulation. And that's the only reason why I'm saying it. It's nothing of substance. It's just changing the word.
Just changing the words, right?
Yeah.
Or this board policy and company. But
this is in the AR. So
this is the AR that they're reading.
Yeah. Right. So what I'm saying is,
yes,
right?
Yeah, so that's
okay.
Right.
Good point.
I don't, I'll change it, but yeah, I just want to make sure you knew that we are in the AR.
One of the other things, and Michelle, this may be more of a question for you, but the first and second unexcused absence here. There's no requirement that the district send a letter after the first and second unexcused absence. The requirement only kicks in when a student becomes truant at three absences.
Right.
So at your discretion, we can remove that requirement if you think it's going to be too burdensome to be getting letters out every time a student has one or two. We're seeing that a lot of our clients are opting not to do the procedure for the first and second unexcused absence, because it's not legally required.
I agree.
So
take that.
Yeah, it's going to require
some rework.
Yeah, why don't I rework that?
So then attachment pay at the bottom will be removed as well.
Correct, and the other attachment numbers will change.
Changes and will be this change.
Michelle, are there going to be substantial changes from the new truancy? In our current practice,
I think just the level of awareness. Yeah, I think that there is some changes in discipline and some professional development. We have a flowchart also that we use to help with this to reinforce the truancy goals.
Okay.
It's hard. Principals will say, I mean, we're going to remove that first one. It's hard to keep up with all of these.
Okay.
You had your PST in that
same. But all that to say is, but we have enough time for this ed to bring it back next time.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go to 215.
look at just from a local procedure standpoint. The draft that's in here now for 215, both the policy and the AR, is simply an option. So it may be customized to local procedures. So if we want to just bring this back for next month, we can do that.
Okay.
If there's specific things that need to be talked about now, we can certainly do that.
So both policy and AR?
Correct. There's some references in here to the number of credits that get required each grade. That's going to be, those numbers are not meant to correspond to upper balance numbers.
I see.
Okay.
So we'll have administrative shift look at that. And then we'll bring it back to committee next time. So moving on to Administrative Regulation 808, Food Services, which is another new policy. Mm-hmm. This is a new policy.
This is a requirement in response to a requirement that the USDA has mm-hmm. that schools have to have a meal charge policy by July 1. One of the things that I'm also going to recommend that we add in here is that there be a provision at the end, and I'll insert it after the meeting, but from time to time, the business office can look at the uncollectible debt, and that has to get written off from non-federal funds if there's delinquent student meal debt.
Actually, we cannot write off the debt any longer. It has to be transferred from the general fund to cover it.
Correct.
Sorry, I was using a kind of terminology, but write-off is not correct.
Yeah.
We've done it once already.
Oh, we've done it twice, so we'll do it again.
Yeah.
So it doesn't even show up as a write-off in the food service account?
That's correct. Food services make hold by the general fund.
Okay. This is also a policy where if there's a different procedure in place locally for meal charging, we can customize this.
Okay, we have a policy 808 already.
We do.
That was adopted June 13, 2016. Is that okay the way it's written?
Correct. Correct.
Yes.
So what's it?
This is a reg, but 808, the policy you're saying is fine.
Correct. We adopted 808. I believe that was in connection with the UGG
it was.
Requirements, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Different school districts handle it differently when students don't have sufficient funds in their meal accounts. Do you let them charge? Do they get an alternative meal? Are they allowed to charge a certain number of meals before they get an alternative meal? Those are all...
Actually, most of that is now regulated again further up the line as far as USDA, I believe, and reimbursements. So I know that oftentimes we never want our children to leave the cafeteria hungry, so there's always an alternative meal that they're able to have. They are only permitted to charge so many, and I don't remember the number right now.
Okay.
I can certainly find that out.
We'll want to incorporate that for next month.
I didn't know what these links were. No charging policy, A1. Parents and guardians are notified, A2.
They're just the footnotes at the bottom of the page.
Okay, I'm sorry.
And we do notify parents. Parents are notified via an electronic system when their children are out of funds.
Okay. It's a nice one, short and sweet.
Yeah.
I'll review this with the director of food service to make sure that.
Do the managers also assist with that?
As far as community, yes. But I'll talk with Kristen as to what the current policy is.
Okay.
We've discussed this at admin council before.
Sure, yeah.
And Brenda, I'll send you, if you'd like, sample language about the right, not the right, make all.
So this needs to come back to committee on the change of it.
And it will need to be in place by July 1.
Yeah.
So we'll just need to watch that.
It is on my radar after the pass out last week.
That's a broad chat for it, so we'll get there. Let's look at AR220, student expression. This is a new proposed regulation.
This is a new one, sorry, I didn't label it. I don't have any agenda, sorry.
This is a policy of an AR that from time to time needs to be relied on when there's threats or other conduct directed to the school that threatens violence. It's something else that we can add to the charges in the case of a student discipline matter.
It's a quick typo in the first bottom of the first paragraph, problem solving as well. Separate the two words. Mm-hmm. First paragraph, the last sentence, problem solved.
I'm stuck on the second sentence. Further, the board ensures the means for the resolution of student-staff board relationship problems within the school structure. What does that mean?
I think it sets you up for the following sentence.
Okay. Channels of communication with respective groups through staff with lines of responsibility, roles, and authority.
It's a little bit awkward, I agree.
So the students may benefit from problem solving based on contributions from each group.
Wow.
Comments on this? I mean, just the final would be that they have, there's another himself or herself, maybe just themselves properly.
Further, as you mentioned, further the board ensures. I don't think that there say a whole lot, and they probably can be taken out.
Okay.
I think that sentence immediately before that suggested improvements to the program are constantly sought and receive fair consideration when presented to the established procedures. I think that's enough.
Okay. Okay, this is an AR, right? I don't see...
I think the policy, 220 policy, is actually more detailed and more helpful.
And
can we pull out policy 220?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is there a specific reason we put this one on there? Was it our recommendation that 220 come on, or?
No. We had some questions about student expression, and it was resolved. So I think maybe if there's not a need for that AR, that would be great. That would be fine.
Let me just go on just the last few things.
Okay with that.
No?
This was last looked at in 14.
But it's my definition of things. It's more robust than that. Than they are. Yeah. This had initially when we had called questions about. We should cover other things.
So this is tied into that.
That's why I actually had come up.
I think that's right.
Mm-hmm. We haven't had a chance to have other discussions yet before we go to an AR.
Right. So. If everyone's okay, we can remove the AR completely.
Yeah.
Yes.
Great. Shall I do this? Once for a discussion happens.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's what's more of my right back.
Yep.
Okay. Can
I would scratch the AR then.
Yes.
Is there
anything
in the area?
Yes.
There's no one here for community input, and right now it's 3:29, and